Hey there, it's Board Game Dave. Today we're looking at Brass Birmingham and whether this is a game for you. Brass Birmingham takes Martin Wallace's original 2007 design and brings it to a whole new level in artwork, gameplay, and production value. It's a very highly acclaimed game and it's currently sitting at number 3 on the Board Game Geek rankings, making it the highest rated game that I own by far. It's also the most complex game I own, tied with Maracaibo. I just got this game recently and I immediately played it twice with Hannah, and I had played it 3 times before then, so I've only played this game 5 times total. With that in mind, this isn't a full review, more of a first impressions after 5 plays, but let's talk about the pros and cons of this game, starting with the pros. First, the art and components. Everything about this game is beautiful. The box, the main board, the player boards, the industry tokens, everything is just gorgeous, lovely art. When I play, I use the iron clays, which come with the deluxe version of this game, but even the cardboard money in this game is beautiful. Everything feels good, looks good, art and components are spectacular. Second, this game is cheap. I only spent $58 on my retail version, although I did buy the iron clays separately, of course. Third, there's a whole lot of player interaction, which you don't always see in Euro games. Sometimes it's cooperative, sometimes it's competitive, but either way, lots of interaction between the players, which is great. Fourth, highly dynamic game state. Almost every action that a player takes is going to affect the board in some way, with new connections being added, or the availability or price of some commodities, or the merchant bonuses, all sorts of things. So it's very fluid and you have to be able to react and respond to different challenges and opportunities that are showing up on the board. Fifth, an ever-changing player order that players themselves can manipulate. This is so much fun. In this game, player order is determined by how much money you spent during your turn, and the less you spent, the higher you go in player order. So you can really kind of tweak that and see how much other people spend before it gets to your turn to see if you can sneak ahead in player order. I love that. Sixth, variable setup. This is something that I understand separates Brass Birmingham from Brass Lancashire. You see, in the beginning of this game, you're going to take these merchant tiles and randomly assign them to different merchant spaces across the board. So each game is going to be different as you move sellable commodities to different areas of the map, depending on where those merchant tiles come out. I love that. The more variability, the more replayability in my mind. Seventh, huge point scoring combos. If you play Brass Birmingham, you know what I mean. In the last game I played, I flipped 4 tiles over with 1 sell action, and it was amazing. So much added income. My score was going to be huge. I took 3 different merchant tile bonuses, so I got to develop and I got to put my income up even further. It was amazing. It feels so good to set up this amazing action and then lay down a card, boom, the chain goes off. You're exploding in income and points. That is like the highest high of this game. I love that so much. Eighth, this game plays great at all player counts. I love it at 2, I love it at 3, I love it at 4 players, and they did a phenomenal job of scaling this game down. See, with 2 players, you take a whole bunch of cards out of the deck and you only use 1 part of the map. With 3 players, you add some more cards and you add 1 section of the map. Of course, with 4 players, you use all the cards and all of the map. It's genius, I love that. Ninth, it's a big, heavy, complex economic simulation Euro. It is so crunchy and brain-burning, and it's great to sit there and you're just analyzing the game state like some kind of titan of industry, looking at the connections, checking out the prices of these raw goods and commodities. I love that. All right, I'm gonna stop saying I love that because we're down to my 10th and final pro for this game. Brass Birmingham does an amazing job of leaning into the theme and the historical context behind this extraordinary period in history. As if it wasn't obvious from the artwork and the aesthetic, even the game board tells you that we're looking at the Industrial Revolution, a period of unprecedented growth and economy. And I have to give a quick shout out to the guys at Heavy Cardboard. Their podcast episode on Brass Birmingham is just mind-blowing. I mean, they love this game, and the way they talked about the historical and thematic connections, it helped me to understand and appreciate this game a lot more, and it makes some of those fiddly rules make a lot more sense. And now it's time for the cons, and yes, there are some, even though I do love this game so much. One of my good board game buddies and I go back and forth on this game because he really doesn't like it, and I get it. You know, it's not a game for everybody. Let's talk about why it might not be for you. First, the dark board and the gloomy aesthetic. If you're into bright, vibrant, happy colors, this game, honestly, honestly might not be for you. You know, this is the Industrial Revolution. It's gritty, it's grimy, it's dirty, and the board represents that. Some people have said that it's a little hard to find the locations on the map, and the first few times you play, it kind of is. Others have complained about the beer barrels being a little too bland, but honestly, I really don't have too much of a problem with either of those two things. Second, this game can be incredibly mean and frustrating. We talked about all that player interaction, but it's not necessarily positive interaction, and you can totally derail somebody's plans, even inadvertently, and some people aren't gonna like that. Third, analysis paralysis. Because of that dynamic game state, it's hard to plan out your actions before it's your turn, which can lead to a lot of thinking time and potentially a lot of downtime between turns. That does mean that the game can go pretty long. We had a 4-player game once that went over 3.5 hours, so that might be a strict no-go for you right there. Fourth, randomness. There is a card drawing element in this game, and sometimes you're just not gonna draw that one card that you need. Now, the game addresses this by having an action where you can draw 2 wild cards, but even still, that might be too much randomness for some people. Fifth, the changing player order. Now, obviously, I find that to be fun, that's a pro, but it can be a little bit hard to keep track of because it's not always gonna go clockwise. It might not even go in order around the table, and it can change every round, so some players are not gonna like that so much. Sixth, a lack of variability. Sure, there are those market tiles, but other than that, setup is exactly the same every time you play, and some players want a little bit more setup randomness in their games. Seventh, some people think that there's a runaway leader problem in this game, or that it's really hard to catch up. Now, I haven't found that to be the case. I think that you probably can catch up from a really bad start, but I also understand how if you're scoring during the canal era and you see that somebody's way ahead of you, it can be kind of crushing knowing that you botched the first half of the game, and yeah, it could be a little bit hard to catch up in the rail era. I understand that. Eighth, fiddliness in the mechanics. And this is totally a valid concern. Honestly, if I was giving this game a rating for intuitive mechanics, it'd probably be like a 5 or a 6. This game has so many caveats and exceptions and clarifications. It's certainly not the most streamlined game in that sense. However, I will say that if you take the time to understand the theme behind this game, that really kind of illuminates why the mechanics work the way they do. Ninth, this game is a brain burner. I mean, it can be exhausting sitting there for hours analyzing the game board and looking for opportunities, reacting to what the other players are doing. It's very tactical, and you know, it can be draining, so you need the right group that's in the right mood for a game like this. Additionally, the teach at best is a beast, okay? I have played the game 3 times. I know the rule book in and out. I had watched countless videos about Brass Birmingham, and when I went to teach Hannah, it was probably just about an hour of teaching the game. So if you don't like games where you have to sit for over half an hour learning the game, Brass Birmingham, I would just skip it. 10th, this theme is not for everybody. Not everyone's gonna find the Industrial Revolution exhilarating and exciting like I do. A lot of people want monsters and demons and spells and dungeons and things like that in their games. You're not gonna find that in this game. And lastly, let's talk about the cost again, because while the retail version isn't too expensive, if you're going for the deluxe version with the iron clays and a couple other upgrades, you're gonna spend at least $90, which is pretty pricey, so take that into consideration too. And there you have it, some pros and cons for Brass Birmingham. I hope you felt like this video gave you a good idea of whether or not this game is right for you. Obviously, it's right for me. I love this game. It's definitely in my top 10 games of all time, if not my top 5. If you found this video helpful, please take a second to like and subscribe, if nothing else, for the sweet vest. And while you're down there, leave a comment. I would love to chat with you. And in the meantime, have a wonderful week, take care, and happy gaming. Bye! Because it's not always going to be clockwise. It's not even always going to be anti-clockwise. It's not even going to be anti... There it is again.